Can we build a COVID-19 simulation model for Singapore? And can we use it to dissect the real meaning behind the case numbers and perhaps even make some predictions on what the future may look like? Let's find out. Hey guys, welcome to another episode of Data Stories. My name is Michael Cho from Urban Zoom. In this series, we typically use data to share with you some interesting stories. And in the past, we focused mostly on the property market. But today, I thought I'll shift gear a little bit and talk about the numbers surrounding COVID-19, specifically the daily case numbers that is being reported in the news. We are bombarded with attention-grabbing headlines, all the numbers coming from the different countries. We even have media outlets literally doing a live streaming of all these results. The question is, how should we interpret these numbers? Is it even meaningful to make comparison that way? Well, in short, you really should take a big pinch of salt when you look at these numbers. And I hope to prove to you by walking you through a fairly simple simulation model to show you what are the main issues if you just take these numbers at their face value. You know, to begin with, I think most of us already have this intuition that the number of cases have got to do with the number of testings being done. You will never fail a test if you never take the test in the first place. But that's just one dimension, right? What if the tests themselves are not that accurate? How about false positives, false negatives? And how about the time lag? We know that for this virus, the people who are infected takes a while before the symptoms start showing up. And worse, we actually have people infected who don't show any symptoms at all. So really a lot of moving parts. As geeks, I think our inclination is to first build a model because really a lot of the variables here are quantifiable. And as the saying goes, all models are wrong, but some can be useful. And turns out a couple of days ago, I actually came across this excellent model done by Nate Silver from 538. So for those of you who never heard of him before, he's a renowned statistician and his claim to fame is when he actually correctly predicted 49 out of the 50 states outcome during the 2008 US presidential election. So anyway, he's written this, you know, in my view, fantastic piece where he basically built a pretty simple model to illustrate why are there so many problems with the reported case numbers that we read in the news every day. So really all credit goes to him. All I'm doing here is to talk you through his model in as simple terms as possible so every one of you will understand. And towards the end, I'm gonna build a custom model unique to the Singapore situation using his model as a base. And of course, you know, I would highly encourage you guys to take a look at his actual blog post, which I'll put in the description below. So let's start with some basic first. Today's date is 21st April 2020. And as of yesterday, 20th April, there were 1,426 new cases reported in Singapore, the highest daily rate yet. Now, all these cases are basically positive tests, and presumably these tests are conducted, you know, at least 1 to 2 days prior to 20th April, say on 18th April. Now, this daily number of tests being done is actually not a public figure, but I'll just put a guesstimate to be roughly 20,000. And the way I infer this is by using what I call a case to test ratio. What do I mean by that? Well, the Ministry of Health in Singapore published that as of 14th April, there were close to 60,000 individuals being tested, while we have a cumulative 3,200 confirmed cases. So therefore a simple ratio of 5.4%. And so if you work backwards, you get that roughly 20,000, right, as a rough gauge. But frankly, it's not really that critical for us to know the precise number, so long someone in the government is actively keeping track of that. That's not the worrying part. The real scary part is literally how many people are really infected out there. And that is the big question mark. So by now, we all know that this virus has an incubation period of say around 5 days from the time you get infected with this virus to the time you start showing symptoms. So really for the cases that are reported on 20th April, chances are they got infected, you know, on 13th April or even earlier. And here I've drawn a circle representing only those that are infected with symptoms. But we also know there are also people who are infected and yet don't show any symptoms. And we've seen reports suggesting that actually as much as 30% of those infected don't show any symptoms. So the actual circle representing the infected, you know, be it with or without symptoms, should actually be bigger than the original rate circle that I've drawn. Now, of course, we don't actually know who is really infected upfront. You know, that's the whole point of testing so that we can find out. But you can see that this problem gets a lot more difficult to solve once you start considering people who are uninfected and yet have similar symptoms. I mean, people get sick, right? People get fever, starts coughing for various reasons, right? But not because of COVID-19. And by definition, if you have this crisis under control, meaning most of the population actually is healthy, right, or basically virus-free, and only a small proportion of people actually have that virus, then the people showing similar symptoms, you know, with fever, with cough and all that, but without COVID-19, could easily outweigh the total number of people infected with this disease. And then finally, this problem seems even more intractable when you start to consider the sheer number of people in the population who are not infected and not showing any symptom. And that will really be the vast majority. But the problem is we have a finite resource in terms of testing capacity, right? It's not like, you know, your regular thermometer. It's DIY, it's multi-use, you know, you one take and you immediately get the results. With the virus test, it's laggy, you know, there's a time lag to it. You can't do it yourself. Presumably you need a nurse to help you with that. So that means you really need to ration that capacity and deploy it wisely. And here's the conundrum, right? Imagine you start deploying the test and you are seeing a high positive result rate, right? Meaning a lot of infection being detected by your number of tests, a high ratio of that. So, but that could mean two things, right? That could mean either that you are doing such a good job deploying the resources wisely, so you're really effective in picking up positive cases, or number two, this is horrible. It could very well be this thing is going out of control. That's why you have such a high positive hit rate. So what gives, and how can you actually model something like this? The decision process that needs to go into the proper rationing of all these tests. Now imagine you start off with a group of folks with severe symptoms, which is smaller than a group with mild symptoms, which is again way smaller than a group without any symptoms. You have limited resources, right? So how? A logical way to do this allocation is to first satisfy all the demands for the severe symptom groups. Then, if you have leftover, take care of say half of those with mild symptoms. And finally, when you have some leftover capacity still, then you can apportion a small group of folks with no symptoms, right? So presumably these would be people that you find out through your contact tracing, you know, without symptom, but say the husband got the virus but the wife have no symptom, but probably still good for the wife to go for a test. So you could apportion things that way, and that's actually how we put all this into the model as well. Now the other thing that you need to consider is how accurate are these tests, right? You know, for instance, even with a thermometer, right, if you do it twice in a row, it's highly likely that you get a somewhat different number, or even left ear to right ear, right, you get a different number, right? And the fact is, there's no such thing as a 100% accurate test in the world. That just isn't. And in the case of COVID-19, it seems that there's a pretty high percentage of what we call false negative, meaning people who actually have the virus and yet the test say you don't have the virus, right? So that's very bad. And there are all these anecdotes of people going for tests and getting a negative result during the first or second try, only in the third attempt then they get tested positive. And there are also reports suggesting that the false negative can be as high as 1/3 of the people who are actually infected, right? So that's a really high false negative number. Now how about false positives? Meaning the test says that you have the virus when you actually don't, right? But for now, it seems that it's much less of an issue. Although you can imagine, this may start to really matter if you really ramp up testing in a huge way. You know, there are people who say, hey, why don't we just create so many tests that you test the whole population, right? The issue with that is because of this false positive, and presumably majority of your population don't have the virus. And because of this false positive rate, which is, even though it's very, very low, but because of the sheer amount of people without the virus, this false positive will still end up being a pretty significant number. So in that case, we will worry ourselves needlessly and even worse, overstress our public health system. And we're gonna actually see how this play out when we build up the actual model. Now, how about the way the virus spread? How do we model the virality of this virus? Well, in the world of epidemiology, I hope I pronounced that right, there's this number called the reproduction rate. R, and that's a very, very important number. What R means is the number of people that would be infected by a single person who has been infected in the first place within a certain period called the infection period. So let me explain. So say we assume an infectious period of 5 days and an R of 3. This means the infected person can infect 3 other people within 5 days. And this is how this thing can spread very quickly. So in day 0, you start off with patient number 1. And 5 days later, you get 3 new infected people, and 5 days later those 3 in turn go and infect 3 other people each, and you get a total of 9 new infected folks here. And pretty soon, in just under 3 weeks, you went from 1 dude to 121 dudes in total. So it literally grew 120 times in 3 weeks. And that's how exponential this thing can get if you don't keep it in check. Some researchers have studied that the natural reproduction rate of this virus is anywhere between 2.5 to 3. That is under so-called normal condition. But then again, you can imagine in the real world, the effective reproduction rate is highly dependent on external environment. For instance, if you live in a dense city or if you live in a very enclosed area for a prolonged period of time, you can imagine the reproduction rate being a lot higher than 2.5 or 3. Conversely, if the whole society is going through social distancing measures, you know, and everyone wash our hands, everyone of us put on face masks, then you could expect the reproduction rate to be way lower, even below 1. And the whole point of this exercise, what we really want to do ultimately is to get R to be less than 1. That means that virus is no longer spreading, in fact, it's shrinking. Of course, you know, we still want a vaccine at the end of the day. I think that's the cure-all thing, right? But the fact is that we don't know when will we get a vaccine, you know, that have no nasty side effects. And even if we have vaccine, right, we actually need that vaccine to be available at such scale that almost majority of the world's population will have access to that, not just the rich countries, because as we've seen so far, this virus doesn't care what passport you hold. So until we get to that point, we really need our basically two things, right? We need social distancing and really keeping very, very good hygiene practice. So actually, all I've mentioned so far are all the inputs that will go into this model. The R factor, the time lag, the false positive, the false negative, etc. And everything I've said so far can be expressed as a number, which means it can be put into Excel spreadsheet and you can generate a model. And this is precisely what Nate Silver has done. And if you're a geek like me, I will highly encourage you to actually download the model and play around with it yourself. Now, what I'm gonna do in part two of this video is to walk you through the actual model, right? How Nate Silver has set this up and present to you two of the scenarios that he's presented. And then on top of that, I'll do a custom model that I built myself that is specific to the case in Singapore. And perhaps from there, that can give us some pointers as to where the near-term future may hold for us. Anyway, I'll stop here for now. If you like the video, I'll really appreciate it if you hit that like button. And of course, if you like more content like this, you know, where we use data to tell you interesting stories, then definitely consider subscribing to this channel. In the meantime, stay safe. I'll see you in the next one.